everyone has started thinking of DevOps, and all the traditional IT companies, Oracle and IBM, are also very much going into the DevOps scenario. So what DevOps is, we'll see, and what was the evolution we'll be seeing, and also like what are the tools, and some people will have a lot of doubts like what is not DevOps, because when you know what is DevOps, you should also know what is not DevOps, and also we'll see what are we going to cover in this session. So we'll see, for every basis, right, any methodology, the ultimate goal is for you to write a responsive, highly available web application or a enterprise application, so that all the users can happily use it, and you want your business to be continuously growing. So that's the ultimate goal of any person or any IT industry. So according to that, right, at the startings of 1960s, we had waterfall methodology. So waterfall methodology was a start of methodology where people used to sit down and write the requirements first. So waterfall methodology was mostly, what you mean is like, it was mainly concentrated on the requirements. So prior 1960s, what people thought is like, if I have correct priorities and correct requirements, right, there is no need of going back and changing or changing your priority or goals. So those people used to put a lot of analysis on requirement phase, and they used to do it, and once they moved past the requirement phase and they started coding, right, if they got any other changes, right, they can't do it. So what if they want to do the change? So again, they need to go to the analysis phase, requirement phase, build phase. So this used to take a lot of time, and the minimum time for a product to come in the waterfall methodology was 6 months. So within more than less than 6 months, you were not going to get any product or any cycle out of it. So that was one of the first methodologies where people started writing Java or like very old codes, which were C or C++. So in the 90s, right, the lean methodology came. So lean methodology was not a software methodology. It was actually developed by Toyota. So they developed it so that they can efficiently maintain their their hardware, their automation softwares, or and their their factories. Not so it their factories, like they implemented some methodologies like remove the unwanted things and remove the communication silos and the slow application response times. So those methodologies were implemented to IT. And when it came to IT, right, what IT people started using is like, if there were unnecessary software features, right, people started removing them so that then the time of deployment will take lesser. And prior to this, there were a lot of communication delays between the teams. So people tried to break it through those communication delays by using email and the basic type of communication, which is chat at the 90s. So people started communicating faster. And the slow response time. So one more lean methodology thing was like, people started slowly identifying where my application is going slow, and they started hitting those bugs. So this was lean methodology, and it was 90s. So since it was not a complete IT one, right, it was not that helpful. Then the Agile came. Agile was around 2001. It was done. So Agile was a very drastic change from the existing methodologies, because Agile, right, the way Agile code was developed is like, currently in waterfall or lean, like what people used to take is they used to take a large set of features, around like 20 or 30 features, then they used to release it. It's like a same difference. So right now Microsoft is not going to release any more version. Windows 10 is the last version of Windows. So what they told is we'll continuously upgrade it. So that's the difference. If you see Windows XP to Windows Vista, right, it's a large change. Instead of that, right, what people started doing is, if you have 20 features, you break it into individual features and you start delivering individual feature within a week time. So what you do is you start getting rapid adaptability, and also if you release a feature within a week, right, you get a customer feedback. So customer tells that, okay, this is not my requirement, can you please change it? So you get the opportunity to take the inputs of your customer and again rapidly develop and deploy the product. So, and you deploy this product in a small incremental builds, not in a larger cycles. So Agile methodology was very good methodology, but due to Agile methodology, right, the builds, right, they were very fastly coming out. But with our traditional methodologies like WebSphere, WebLogic, right, we were not able to scale the infrastructure as fast as Agile people writing the code. Agile started writing the code. It means in Agile, right, there will be a Scrum Master, they'll have a call every day, and they'll keep pushing the builds every day. But we didn't have the operation side, right, we were not correctly equipped to handle those many type of requests either it's a build request or a deployment request. So from agile methodology, what you say, all the issues, right, DevOps has born. So what is DevOps is the agile methodology combined with the efficient development operations is called as a DevOps. So the faster the build, we need to have a faster mechanism to deploy it and provision a server and take that code to the production as soon as possible. So we'll see now what is DevOps. So if you implement DevOps, we'll see what are you going to get the benefits by implementing it. So faster time to market, because when you have when you can build a server within second the code, right, instead of you taking a 2 months of time, like you buy the hardware, you install that hardware in the rack, then the network team will be and they'll add a DNS, it they'll configure the DNS in it so that it will be discoverable in your data center. Once it's discovered, again the firewall team will install some software, and again the network team, the operating system OS support team will come, then the middleware team comes in, installs WebLogic or WebSphere or MQ, then you configure it again, you do that for the lower environment, higher environment, prod, non-prod, stage. So instead of this, right, if you have a DevOps tool, right, you can start a server within a 15-minute window. You can build a server and you can install your Tomcat, you can push your software within 15 minutes and give that server details to the developer so that he can efficiently check his code, and again, if he needs a new server, we can destroy the servers and build a new server. So if you are going to do that 2 months or 1 month of time into within minutes, right, you are going to do a lot of testing, you'll try to fix all your issues and bugs at the lower level itself. So that's the faster time to market. Lower cost to deliver, because why the cost becomes decreases, because if you find a bug in production, right, it's going to be a huge loss to the company, either it may be a financial loss or a customer satisfaction loss. That's not going to happen. No vendor lock-in. All the prior tools, right, what we use, WebLogic, WebSphere, right, moving from WebSphere or WebLogic to another thing is a huge task for us. It may take 1 or 2 years because all your binaries or libraries will be mostly vendor lock-in. So DevOps, once you come to DevOps, right, most of the tools all will be open source and there will not be any vendor lock-in. So that's the advantage. Your total cost of ownership for your software products will be drastically decreased. You only pay for a small support cost, but you'll not be paying the huge money for buying that version, because when you upgrade from WebLogic 10 to 11 or 11 to 12c, right, it's going to be very costly. So a version upgrade, a bug fix, all will be easy, and it will be higher quality, because since you are doing rapid iterations and you do high number of testing, right, you will not be having any, you will get fewer bugs. So that's the same thing which is a lower cost to deliver. The multi-cloud. So multi-cloud is not yet completely implemented yet. So I think it will be coming into the market in next 1 to 2 years. So right now, right, if you go to Amazon AWS or Azure, right, it's completely logged in, because the way Amazon and Microsoft implement the cloud is little different. So once a DevOps can go through multi-cloud, right, then it will become a complete DevOps. Right now, the DevOps can be implemented inside your cloud or inside your data center or in a cloud, but not a multi-cloud. So once you are able to move your complete applications, everything from one cloud to other cloud, then that will be the most efficient form of DevOps. Yeah, any doubts, guys?
Yeah, Gautam, this is Hari. So can you come again, no vendor lock-in, so can you explain it again?
Yeah, so no vendor lock-in is like, there are I'll take an example. So Gautam, you have multiple stages in DevOps. One is deployment. Yeah,
can you make the PowerPoint full screen?
Sure. Yeah, I'll take an example. So currently you have a Puppet. See, there are multiple stages of deployment. So in one stage is continuous delivery. So continuous delivery is like taking your code and deploying it in multiple instances. So for that, right, we have a 4 or 5 things. One is Chef, Puppet, Ansible, and StallStack. These are the 4 major ones where you can use to do your continuous delivery thing. So if you are already you have already implemented Puppet in your environment, and if you want to move it, right, moving out of Puppet to Chef is very easier, because you are not you're not going, you have not paid huge sum of money, because once you implement WebLogic, right, you have around 400 servers or 500 servers in a small environment, you pay a huge money. Once you pay the money, right, you feel like, okay, I've already paid a huge money to IBM or Oracle, why should I move out? So that's the vendor lock-in, because due to your already prior commitments, right, you will not have a compelling reason to move out. Since you are on open source and these open source tools have a very good support, it is very easier to move from one implementation to other implementation. Means you are using Ant for your build, you can easily move to Maven, because you don't have any vendor lock-in, because you are not paying upfront fees, you are not locked in anywhere, right? That's the vendor lock-in concept. You understood?
Hi, Gautam, I have a small question over here.
Yeah.
And you were comparing that WebLogic VAS, right? So in WebLogic VAS, we can able to deploy it in Java applications where you can access your websites. But in Puppet and Chef, are they, we deploy any applications? I mean, did they support anything?
See, Puppet and Jeff are continuous delivery. So these are delivery tools. See, at the end point, you can have a Tomcat. See, these DevOps, right, these DevOps are not yet completely implemented in your traditional data centers. These don't interact as easily as possible like to your old applications like WebLogic and WebSphere. These started, right now, DevOps are completely manageable using Tomcat and Nginx and Apache, but they are not yet completely integrated with our old software. So most of the time when people use DevOps, right, are with the startups, Netflix, Airbnb, your WhatsApp, all these, right, these are all container services and they are all API based. So that's why DevOps, right, still it's not implemented completely in our data centers. Right now it's slowly being implemented. DevOps, right, as a whole DevOps you can't implement in your traditional data center. What we can slowly start is implement Puppet and Chef and make sure that all our servers are in the same state. All our applications are having the same code, same Java version, same installation locations. Are they completely having security features? So it's just slowly we can't implement the way a startup uses a DevOps in a traditional data center environment, because you can't remove your Java applications which are being used from past 14 or 15 years, right? Because you can't, ask your office or your company to completely will scrap our Java applications and we'll go to API based applications or container based applications. That's not going to be possible. So that's why the way a startup uses DevOps and a traditional company uses DevOps is a lot different. We'll only be using a couple of things, but once you go to a startup, right, they don't have an option, because if you see Flipkart, right, Flipkart doesn't have any traditional softwares. They have their web servers on Nginx and they have all their code in Node.js and Angular. So because they have easily movable parts, so they, because when they are new, right, they didn't go to all these traditional Java based containers, your WebLogic, WebSphere or MQ, because they'll be using RabbitMQ which is open source, all these things. When these open source things come to picture, right, DevOps can be fully utilized. Otherwise we'll have only a couple of small components where you can slowly integrate your DevOps.
Okay, thank you.
So these are a couple of things where you'll have issues, because if you don't implement DevOps, there may be, these are some of the causes which can happen. See, you don't discover software defects until late in the life cycle or in the production. So you use your agile and speed development, but you don't get any gains, because once the app goes into production, it can't handle the load, because it was not efficiently tested on the operation side. Though it was tested on a development side, you have not checked its operation side. So your developers and testers will be constantly waiting for the access to resources, because if you take more than 2 months or 1 month to build a server, a WebLogic or WebSphere server and give them, right, they can't wait that long for just a server needs. And pinpointing the problems across will also be very hard, because you don't have all the automation in place. So most of the work needs to be done manually and it will take a lot of time. And since we'll be doing manual deployments, there will be a lot of human errors. And the other thing is, like in a DevOps, right, DevOps is nothing but, it's not some of, if you implement 5 tools, right, you can't tell DevOps. DevOps is a methodology and it's a thinking. So the way people start interacting with each other will be a lot different in a DevOps. So your developers, your operations time, people should always communicate each other, and they need to plan each other, plan along with each other. It's not like, okay, once a developer writes in or write, he'll tell, okay, I have written my code, I have tested it on one server, it will work fine. So this pinpointing to others, right, will be a lot decreased, because everyone will be working in sync to see what's the issues. Right now we'll have most of the scenarios, right? Run team will tell, okay, we don't see an issue. Application testing team will tell, okay, we had a correct. So that will not be there anymore. So what is DevOps? Because why DevOps we have seen, we'll see what is DevOps. So DevOps is not a product or even a particular technology. It's a methodology that unites the functions of the software development and also the production and operations into a single integrated and continuous process. See, DevOps is a continuous process. You continuously take, you build it, you deploy it, you take the feedback, again you start taking the requirements. It's a continuous cycle, it never stops. So it's about the breaking down the barriers. So it's like, okay, your the software development team has a different manager, your operations team has a different manager. Here it will be a combined managers where they take the concept of people, process and technology, and they take that into innovation. So they can move forward very fastly instead of like having a lot of troubleshooting calls, all these things. You can have automated softwares doing a lot of helping for us. So the once you integrate these five phases into your environment, right, then that environment can all be a complete DevOps environment. So these five phases will have as different tools to implement. So testing will have a lot of integration. CI has Jenkins, CDN, continuous delivery and continuous deployment will have tools, continuous monitoring will have tools. Once you have all these five tools working in autonomous fashion, then that concept will be called a DevOps. DevOps is not a single concept, if I do. So it's a five-phased concept. First is a collaborative development. Collaborative development means people start integrating with all the other development teams. Means, okay, one team will be only writing one software, because in Agile, right, people need to collaborate with each other. They have a call every day. They continuously talk to each other. So that is collaborative development. If waterfall or the other developments, right, people give them a requirement, he comes back after 10 days and he'll tell, okay, this is what I have written, can you please test? That's not going to happen. You have a collaborative development. You interact with each other, all the developers. That is collaborative development. Continuous testing is whenever a new development code has been written, right, it will be tested then and there instead of it moving to another environment. So once you write a Java code and you check it into your code repository, either it is GitHub, JIT or SVN, all this code repository, right, the moment it is pushed in, right, we have automated concepts built in so that it will be tested with that small single change. So if people do 100 changes, right, there will be 100 builds happening simultaneously in your environment. That is continuous testing. Single developer does a change, it will do. If two people have pushed the change, it will do. You can schedule it, okay. You can schedule it like, okay, if there is a small change in my SVN repository or my GitHub repository, I want a test happen on that build. So you can configure based on your development, your testing will be continuous. So once a continuous testing happens, then the continuous integration happens. Once a continuous integration comes, so continuous integration are the Jenkins. So continuous integration concept, well, I'll be telling you, but the technology which will be in the phase 3 is a Jenkins. So what Jenkins does is, it will be continuously integrating all your development, testing and build phases in an automated fashion. Once you have your code written, automatically tested, automatically build, right, what you'll do, you'll deploy it. What we use continuous deployment tools, there are four tools which are Puppet, Chef and Ansible. So Puppet is the first one. It was developed around 2005. It was early to the market. Puppet has a lot of market share than others, but right now Chef is also very famous because Chef has a lot of development features. Means its developers will like it a lot because it's written in natively in Puppet, in Ruby. Puppet is also Ruby. It's a little not complete 100% Ruby, but it's a little derivative of Ruby. Continuous monitoring. So once you have your continuous monitoring, right, you have a lot of network devices, hardwares, your application softwares, all these things, right. Prior to this, we used to have different monitoring tools like Introscope Dynatrace for application monitoring and other tools for your network monitoring. So we have a new tools in DevOps where they do all type of network devices and applications with a single software, and they will also be integrated continuously. So the New Relic and Nagios, right, they come into the continuous monitoring. When once these five phases are automated, right, without manual intervention, then that will become a DevOps. Guys, got it? I think you'll get a lot of tips.
No, yeah, Gautam, this is Ramesh again. Yes. So you mentioned and Puppet, Chef, and Nagios, right? So these are all three.
No, no.
Three.
Puppet, Chef, Ansible, and Salt Stack.
Sorry?
Salt Stack, Salt. Our general Salt, salt, right? Salt. Salt Stack.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So salt Ansible stack. Has been yeah Salt Stack. So okay. Right now Ansible is getting slowly because you know this Red Hat, right? Red Hat has bought the Ansible, but Chef and Puppet are still with the open source guys. But this is bought with a single organization, so people are not implementing Ansible because again it will become a traditional software. He'll start charging money. So Puppet and Puppet are still open source, mainly maintained by open source guys. So those are the most important ones. Yeah,
so
you had some other doubt?
These three tools are also achieving the same thing, right? I mean automation.
Yes.
I mean, so what you mentioned, continuous testing and continuous integration, right?
Yeah, so these, whatever you told, right, the Puppet, Chef, all these three tools, right, they'll be the continuous delivery and deployment. So once you have a code, right, you want that code to be pushed to 1,000 servers with a minimal effort. So Puppet and Chef does that. So what they do is, I'll be telling you in a minute, what they do is they'll push your software as easily possible, because right now if you want to do a deployment, right, 100 servers, it's going to be a huge manual task. But they can deploy their software across servers or across data centers very, very easily.
Okay.
Hello. Hello, Gautam.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt you. This is Kaja here.
Yes.
Yeah, can we go, then what is the use of Jenkins here?
Jenkins is a pipeline. Jenkins is the heart of DevOps. So Jenkins, what it does is, I'll tell you an example. You have a, okay, there is a developer. He has completely written his Java code, and he has pushed all his updates to SVN. You know SVN, right? Code repositories, SVN, GitHub, all this?
Yes, sir.
So once he has written, right, Jenkins has automated jobs there. They are already scheduled. Jenkins job, what it does is, it will continuously monitor, are there any changes on the your code side. Once it monitors a change, right, it will take the change and it will start building it based using Maven or Ant. Once it builds, right, again it will take that and it will deploy it on a Tomcat. Jenkins does it. So Jenkins, once the Jenkins deploys it, right, Jenkins again checks that whether it was a successful deployment on your Tomcat or WebLogic. Jenkins can also talk to WebLogic and WebSphere right now. So it will deploy it. Once the deployment is successful, right, once it knows that, it will automatically kick in the JUnit test. Means the right now, if you want manual test or performance test, right, using your all your tools, it will, you can write your already your JUnit test and integrate it. Once it understands that WebLogic deployment is successful, it will start the JUnit test. After the JUnit test, it will send us the results. So Jenkins, right, it has a pipeline for a testing environment. But you can't, it's not preferable to use the Jenkins to push the code to the production, because once you have this, all your Jenkins testing happen, right, we will take that code and push it through the Puppet or Chef delivery method. But Puppet is a but Jenkins is a heart of any of the DevOps culture, because it is going to automate all your five parts into a single thing. Jenkins does all these five things in a single place. So Jenkins again can start the Nagios monitoring automatically, and it can take the methods. So Jenkins is a pipeline. So you can give any type of jobs and it will continuously do the jobs. That is called continuous integration.
Okay.
But when you...
You mean to say that Jenkins is different comparing with Puppet and Chef, right?
Yes.
Different tool.
Puppet and Chef, they are only used to push the desired state and install or configure. I'll tell you one example which what a Puppet can do. So there is a desired state configuration based on this Puppet and Chef. I'll tell you. See, there must be a file always. You have OPT, IBM something, or OPT, some Oracle directory, and you should always have a sample.txt file. If the sample.txt file is not there, Puppet continuously checks it, and it has a repository. Okay, sample.txt file should be there. If it is not there, it will on the spot, it will create it and push that file to that specific server, because if some team accidentally deletes it, right, which is important for your configuration, it will always make sure your infrastructure always is in desired state. If you tell that my WebLogic should always be up and running, if it monitors that, okay, its WebLogic is not running, it will go ahead and run it. It will start the services. It is a desired state configuration. If you want to push your development code, you can push it. If you want to have your file system in a certain state, it can do it. It is a development. It will not do any testing or anything. It is a client-server architecture. On the server side, I'll tell, I want this code to be pushed to this 500 servers, it will do it. If I'll tell, okay, can you install Tomcat and start the Tomcat instance, it can do it. But it will not have a pipeline stage as a Jenkins. It's okay. Only to push your code and have your configuration in desired state. If you'll tell, okay, my XML file should have all these contents. If it is not there, then Puppet and or Chef should update that file and save it. So it can do that.
Okay. Thanks, sir.
I just want to add a few more points. Like, if you are going to take WebLogic, WebSphere, JBoss, or any infrastructure you want to use for a Java application deployment, it is going to use Puppet, Chef, Salt, and Ansible for installation configuration part. And coming to the Jenkins, Hudson, Bamboo, all these tools are like integration tools, pipeline tools, one job after another job. In a sequence, you want to do something, then we are going for these tools. So not necessary to use all the tools. If you know one of the tools, then that would be great.
In the Jenkins, right, in Jenkins, one of the pipeline, what you can ask the chef is, build a new server, install new instance of Tomcat, configure it, everything, and build in that. But see, Jenkins can't be used on a huge infrastructure level. Jenkins can only be used on a test cases or integration. Once you want to push that code efficiently onto hundreds of production servers, right, Jenkins is not that stable or not preferable. What you do is, most of the people, right, for continuous integration sometimes, only for the deployment. See, continuous delivery is there, continuous deployment is there, right? So continuous delivery, you use your Puppet and Chef. So still most of the enterprise companies, right, they don't have confidence on this delivery pipeline. So what they do is, the most famous one is IBM Urban Deploy. So IBM Urban Deploy will be used. It's not only for IBM software, but all the other software companies will use. So IBM Urban Deploy can be used to deploy it, because IBM Urban Deployment can do multiple steps again in job status, like it will configure JDBC resources, it will configure your jar files, it will update your configuration inside WebSphere or WebLogic, and it will deploy it. And if you are going to rollback, right, it's going to do the same sequence in a rollback fashion. So people are not yet completely into this, what you say, because the way this WebLogic and WebSphere has a different pipelines, right? There are some paid tools in place, but if you are going to have your complete DevOps, right, you need to have Jenkins and the Chef compulsorily. That those are the minimum tools someone to implement a DevOps in their environment. Right now, if you see, right, all your very big companies like Wells Fargo, GPMC, they have Puppet or Chef in them, and they are slowly moving into those. Because if you implement Puppet and Chef, there is not going to be a huge change in infrastructure. What you are going to do is, you are making sure your desired state configuration. What is desired state is, like, every staging, all your automation will be done. You'll be continuously monitoring your file systems. If you want to install a new WebLogic, you can do that within minutes. You'll have a specific chef job. The chef will execute the job on all the nodes where you want to install. So we are slowly taking the DevOps culture, but it's not a complete change. So that's the difference. But and some teams, right, they are already using Jenkins. Most of the companies are already using Jenkins, because Jenkins can be easily be integrated into your Agile methodology. Because Agile is like, you want continuous testing and development, not the continuous operations. So Jenkins was already a famous tool because it's already being from long time. But now the Chef and Puppet are being implemented in your data centers.
Okay.
You got your answer cleared?
Yes.
Yeah, so I told, right, But other than if you take Fortune 500 or Fortune 1000, right, by next couple of years, everyone will be in DevOps. Because the cost savings, everything are very huge. And if you want a hybrid cloud, right, and if you want to start interacting with any cloud services, you need to have a DevOps culture in your private cloud so that you can start talking to a public cloud. Because if you have your old style of data center, some companies right now, what they are doing is they are slowly taking their testing all those phases, because they don't want their production deployments or production code to be run through cloud, but they are completely integrating their testing development phases to the cloud. So if you want your development and testing phases in the same manner, right, what they need to do is they need to slowly integrate their DevOps. That is the main aim. I already know a couple of large companies, they are already having private cloud. What is private cloud? They have their own cloud within their own data center. So they're starting to experiment with that, and they'll slowly move to the cloud. But eventually moving to this, what you say, the cloud environment or the DevOps, right, is 100% for sure. So it's why, like, right now it's not yet adopted, but within 1-2 years it will be completely adopted.
Gautam, here a small question. So yes. Are the tools any, I mean, for any tools, you listed some of the tools, right? So these tools, yes, will support any, I mean, AWS cloud or in Amazon Azure cloud?
Yes, you can manage any number of clouds, because you'll be having a same type of infrastructure. Because once a Chef starts interacting, Chef understands the same concept as any other server. So it's platform independence. Once you start managing your infrastructure from the Chef, right, everything will be the same.
No. My question is here. See, my applications is running into the in Azure cloud. Just assume it. So my development is there, and infrastructure is there in my side. Okay. So I want to be do these deployments through in my application in my server where it is running in the Azure. It's a public cloud. So is it possible, okay, this kind of integration?
This kind of integration is only possible if you have the same type of your services configured. If I'm telling you right, so if you have your same configuration there, right, you can push it, but you can push it only from the cloud end right now. I mean, you need to have your Gen pipeline, which is also inside your Amazon Insight, then you can push it. See, I'm telling you, they will be maintained independently, but for the consistency, you need to start implementing those tools in your environment. It's not like, okay, I'll start pushing my code to there. It's not possible. Right now, they're only possible through APIs. So APIs you can push. So you can configure an API which can be used from your cloud and this one. So I'll tell you an example. You have an API. So you have a service. That service, right, can be load balanced between your data center and your cloud right now. That is possible. But management is not possible, because the way AWS and Azure, right, they maintain the instances is a lot different. The way you log in is different, the way you manage is different, the way you create an instance is different, all those are different. That's why I'm telling you, the multi-cloud is not yet implemented, because people don't want still that much freedom to be given to people, so that there will be a lot of revenue loss to those companies. Because if you have a chance to move all your AWS to Amazon within a second, right, if AWS just increases as 1 cent or 2 cent for their loads, right, you'll think, okay, why should I pay this much of money? You'll move. So that is not yet possible. So there's a small difference between your continuous delivery and continuous deployment. So continuous delivery is only delivering your code to the non-production environments, up till the all the type of non-production environments, but not the production environments. Continuous deployment means you have an automated fashion of deployment in your production environment also. So the only difference between a continuous delivery and deployment is the continuous deployment signifies that you have a automated delivery pipeline configured in your production environment also. So some people will continuously think what's the difference, but that's a small difference. If you have a deployment, telling means they have a production also automated fashion. So most of the people still use continuous delivery because they don't believe in your tools to deploy your production code. So people do their Agile methodology and DevOps methodology as soon as possible, and they do a manual things to their production.
Yeah, of course, right. In this production, there have to be a lot of teams will involve and do the testing after their deployment. All this stuff is involved, right? So
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So
thank you.
Yeah, that is the difference between delivery and deployment.
Okay.
So this is a pipeline I'm showing you. It's still the same example. So so the only step manually is your deployment to production. So the post-deployment is your unit testing, the platform testing, delivery to staging, delivery, your application acceptance, all this will be automation. But the only difference between delivery and deployment is your the code pushed to your development environment, to the production environment. So this is a one, again I'm showing you the cycle again. So when you plan your application, how you are going to build it, then you build your then you develop your application, then you build it, that comes to your agile development. Once you build your development and you test it right, because what Jenkins does is, this is the Jenkins part, continuous integration. You continuously build it, so Jenkins will take that code, it will build that code using Ant and Maven, again it will test that code and it will run the JUnit test. So this part, right, these four parts are called the continuous integration. Once you take that perfect code and you push that into your, you release that code, right, you release and means you release, I mean you are releasing, you do a release, what we do a release means you will be deploying the latest code to the development production environment is called a release. So once you do a release, right, that will become a continuous delivery. So all these parts, once you have automated fashion delivered, is called a DevOps. So this, the continuous monitoring, I haven't written much because they are all very small. New Relic and Nagios are the most famous now. So guys, you got it right. So what is DevOps?
Yeah, what is Agile development?
Agile development is a methodology where you break your application planning, right? So you have a, I'll tell you an example. So if instead of releasing major version, you have a iPhone version like 7 to 9, so Agile methodology doesn't see on this major versions. What they do is, they take your features and break down to very very small individual pieces, and they continuously do a collaborative process. What is a collaborative process? They write the code today, they deploy it, again they take a feedback from the testing team and the production team, and again they develop it. So it's a continuous improvement into their own code, instead of like, right, okay, I'll keep writing my code for 6 months and again I'll push it to testing, again testing will come back. It's not like that. You have a continuous pipeline. So you have some agile methodology, right, there is a scrum master. It's a new development methodology where the way the code is developed is a lot different than your lean methodology or waterfall methodology. You have a continuous feedback. That feedback loop will push the new changes to your agile methodology. Yeah, I think Agile is already used a lot. Yeah. Tell me.
Yeah, is there any difference between Puppet and Chef? Are they working for the same function or do they have any difference?
The same function. They will be working for the same function. They have 90% of the same features. They both have plugins or plugin concepts or store concept. You can add features. It's the same. You can both are built on Ruby. You know Ruby, right? It's a scripting language, same as Perl or Python. Both are built on Ruby. So when you are going to extremely customize your Puppet or Chef language, you need to learn the Chef Ruby language. So Chef is completely if you know complete Ruby, right, you can implement it. But Chef, right, Puppet, right, it's a DSL based Ruby. So it's a domain specific language. There will be a little its own based commands and APIs other than the Ruby. But both are built on Ruby. So if you are going to do extreme customization, then you need to know Ruby language. But most of the time, we'll have all these automated scripts already in the it's in their marketplace. You can download them. They both have marketplaces, means like app store types. So you can download a specific type of automation tasks. You have some automation tasks for Nagios, right? There will be so many good developers already written. Since it's an open source, and people share their implementation in open source, so you can take that and tweaks, do some changes, and you can use it to your environment. No need to start writing for Nagios, all those things. Most of the automation tags will already be there in their marketplaces. Mm-hmm. So we'll see the tools. Yeah.
So what we are doing with Puppet and Chef means building the software and deploying the code, right? So
it's only deploying. Building is Jenkins part. Deploying, it's only deploying part.
But building the software, like installing and configuration.
Yeah, installing and configuration. Yes, installing and configuration is install, configure, and also operate. Operate is a maintaining your desired state. If my WebLogic goes down, it'll know it and it'll start it. It's operation part and also deployment part. See, this is I'll start from your planning and coding. So your planning and coding. JIT is an open source. Jira is a it's a money-based one, so it's not open source. It's again license-based. So right now, Atlassian, right? You are you guys aware of Atlassian company? So it's a new company. They all have tools, whatever the open source tools are there, right? They have their own tools which are all licensed based. So some companies, right, who don't believe in open source, they do it, but the Atlassian market share is very less, since again they are all closed source and we don't know the source code what Jira does. So still companies are not implementing that, but they are only implement this Jira. The Jira is the famous in their company, but any other thing, no one is implementing there, all those open source tools, DevOps tools. Only Jira is a little famous in the in that company. It's an Atlassian product. There are a lot of Atlassian products from the DevOps tools. So once you plan your
Jira
code, right?
No, Jira is a ticketing tool, right?
Jira is a ticketing tool. Jira is also a versioning. Yeah. Jira is not only ticketing tool. Jira can also, because Jira, right, when you open a requirement, right, you update your requirement, it's a collaboration tool. Jira can also be used as a collaboration. That's why it's used in the planning stage.
Yes,
Jira can also be used instead of your, what do you say, your service desk, service node or your brocade, all this, but Jira mostly, right, in a DevOps methodology, Jira will be used in the planning phase, because people continuously track their tickets and they see the requirements in their Jira. Because Jira doesn't have tell me.
It is like a version control system, right?
Not version control system, again. But means it can only be right now used as a a ticketing tool and also to monitor your changes. So it's like you can open loop, what do you say, a ticket or any what you say, it can be used version tracking. It's the version tracking through code, but version tracking through you open some ticket to your team and version tracking. The working the most is your GitHub only. Everyone uses it. There is no content for version tracking.
Yeah, some program you are having and it is having some modules. One module Hari will do, another module.
So the other is built. This is your Ant, this is your Maven, this is your.
You can use the Jira for tracking how much part is completed.
Your voice is brilliant. Yes, yeah, how much part is completed, all those things, yes. So it's a tracking tool within mainly used for your development teams, not for your production support part. That's why I just wanted to tell you that, because people don't use Jira the way we use for ServiceNow or like what do you say, Pack 2000 tools. Oh, what you told, it is possible, but right now it's not used for that purposes. It's used a little different purposes.
And Gautam, will you?
Because it will not have that much.
Will you talk installation and configuration of the Jira also in this?
Jira I have not covered, because I am only concentrated on open source, because we don't know when this closed source or license based or not working right. But if you want, I can try to accommodate it. There's no problem.
Okay.
I mean, what are the tools are we going to cover in this? Gautam, what are the tools
I'll tell you,
are we going to cover
slide.
In this session? Okay, thank you. Yeah.
So. In the next slide, I'll be telling. Yeah. Okay. So once we plan and code, we'll be using the build and Maven. So the most one is the Maven, because Maven is what you say, it's the next stage of Ant. So Ant is very old now. It's not that feature rich. So Maven is the most feature rich now. Maven is the most used build tool. What is build? Your Java developers all write .java files and they push into their repository, which is Git. So what Maven does is it will take those Java files, and it will compile it to .class files. So whenever you build a ER, a var, or all those jar files, right, they always have .class file. That's why you can't open your source code when you deploy it, because you can't open it, because it's already been compiled. So it's always easier to run a compile code instead of you compile it, build it, and run it. So that's why. And it also does this, what? It will automatically pull in all the dependencies. If you can have some shared libraries or some external libraries, and it will also build your deployment descriptor, how to deploy the tool, all will be done on by the Maven part. once it's built, it will be done the testing. We have the JUnit SE. So the most famous one is the JUnit. So we have, what the JUnit does is, our testing team writes the test cases, right? You can use the test cases and configure those test cases in the JUnit, and you can tell the Jenkins that, okay, whenever specific deployment code is deployed and it's started, go ahead and run this automated test, so that you don't need any manual intervention from the testing team that, okay, hi team, this testing is completed, can you please start, deployment is completed, can you go ahead and start testing. That's not required because everything is already in the pipeline. Once you have everything in place, what you do, this is all your non-production phase, this is your production phase. You deploy it using all this Puppet, Chef, SaltStack and Ansible, then you also operate it, because if you feel that there is a difference within the web version, you can on the fly upgrade a version, or you can stop and start your services. Then you can monitor it. What is monitoring? You monitor your code for any abrupt changes or any high usage issues, which are used by New Relic, Senso and Nagios. So New Relic is a licensed product and Nagios is open source, but New Relic is a lot used now. But Nagios, what Nagios has done is, Nagios is a it can be a lot of extensibilities happening in the Nagios, and people tend to use because it's a lot of open source and there's a lot of support for it. You have a lot of scripts, open source scripts, you can easily find Nagios and you can implement it in your environments. So see, Jenkins sits in the main part because Jenkins can talk to all of these guys. So this is the integration part. So most of the time, right, Jenkins will be heart of your DevOps methodology in your environment, because once you have all these phases, right, Jenkins can come and give instructions to each and every this guy. Because if you have Jenkins, right, you don't have JIT, if you don't have JUnit, if you don't have Puppet, if you don't have these guys, right, you can't automate or build a pipeline using Jenkins. So for Jenkins to work completely, you need all these guys already set up. Then you can come to your Jenkins and start building your pipelines. If you don't have this deploy, right, how can you automate your DevOps environment? Because you can only plan it and test it and you can stop it. You can't deploy it. You can only deploy through these tools. That's why Jenkins will always be heart of your any DevOps methodology. So this is one more slide. I think you will not be able to see, but once I share, you can see. This is like a periodic table. It's a periodic table for your DevOps environment. So I can zoom in.
Yeah, Gautam, there is one question. So
yes.
What is the role of Docker?
Okay, Docker is advanced version of, yeah. So Docker, right, right now, most of the softwares in the world are not Docker compatible, because what Docker is, I'll tell you. So you have a VMware, right? Everyone has a ESX servers in their environment. That's common now. So what ESX does is, you install your ESX software on top of a pure hardware. You have an hardware. You install your VMware server in that. Inside that VMware server, again, what you'll do? You'll install your whatever server you want. Either it's a Red Hat server or a Linux server or Windows server. So with this, right, there is a lot of complexity. What Docker is, you can directly take a virtual container and install directly on your hardware itself. You don't have this VMware complex to directly interact hardware, but it's a container. It's a type of virtual server, but to deploy that virtual server, you don't need any other container like a VMware or anything. It can be directly deployed onto your hardware. That is a simple concept. So what, again, Docker is like, Docker is a built-in container, means it can't have all the OS resources. It will only have a set of OS resources which will be isolated to that operating system. You have a Red Hat example, you have a RSL server and you build a Docker in that. So whatever you give the Docker resources, right, Docker can only use the resources. You will tell that, okay, my Docker instance should only use the ports from 22,000 to 23,000. Only that set of 1,000 ports will be used by Docker. So Docker provides isolation and it also helps you building virtual servers on the hardware itself. So it's like removing the complexity, because right now, right, if you create servers on VM, right, a lot of processing power will be wasted to maintain your VMware software instead, you, if you remove that VMware complete layer, right, you'll get a lot of still processing power there in your infrastructure, which can be continuously used. Yeah, which can be used most of the for your applications instead of maintaining the servers. You got an idea?
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, and right now, right, most of your applications are not built to run in a container, because it's once you put any application inside a Docker, right, it becomes containerized application. So containerized application will not can't run as independently as as running inside a operating system. So you need to completely change your application to run inside a Docker. So Docker is an advanced implementation of your DevOps, and most of the companies still don't have Docker with them. I'm already going to cover Docker, but Docker, you can't have most of your applications still to test it. So IBM has released one of their WebSphere product, which is called IBM Liberty Core. So IBM Liberty Core is a very small version of your IBM WebSphere, which can be run inside a containers. So I'm not sure whether there is a equivalent to WebLogic which can run inside Docker, but IBM has released a type of application server which can be run inside Docker. So because the way Docker runs is it's a little different, so that's why the traditional softwares can't run inside. All your traditional softwares can be used to manage in a DevOps integration, but whenever you want something to be run inside Docker, then it should be completely rewritten. Whatever your application should be rewritten. That's the main topic.
12c support, Gautam. WebLogic 12c, they have started supporting the Docker.
Yeah, because why 12c and not the older versions is, the way Docker runs is a lot different. I told you, right, it only has a limited resources when you compare it to operating to the whole operating system. That's why you need to make that application to be a container-based application. Yeah. Docker slowly, most of the applications, so installing maintaining Docker is a lot easier, but implementation of Docker is very, very less inside the organization, because they need to change. If you have a, if you don't have Docker also in a normal data center, right, you can slowly integrate these parts. But if you want your Docker to be implemented, then the whole your existing code should be scrapped and written from the start. So that's why people are not yet implementing Docker. Docker only will be implemented by most of the Google, Microsoft, Facebook, right? They'll be extensively be using the Docker, because Docker can be containerized. Your application should be containerized. Gmail, right? Gmail will be running in thousands and thousands of containers inside Google, which is a Kubernetes. So a type of Docker, there is an alternative to Docker called Kubernetes. Kubernetes was developed by Google and open source now. So it's also a type of container, and Google has all those main services running inside those services, because they have completely written their code. So that's a Docker or Kubernetes, both are both function as same containerized applications.
So it means it doesn't require any operating system, right? Directly talks to the hardware, and the application will be mounted to that Docker, right?
Yes. But that level still not anyone using right now. What most of the companies are using is they have a physical server. Inside those physical server, they are building they are creating a lot of Docker instances. Docker gives a lot of isolation, because it gives you isolation container, and there will be less chances of breaking it. Because if you have an operating system, right, there may be some network issue, everything happening, due to that your application breaks it. But once you put inside a Docker, right, it will be a safe and containerized application, and it will be isolated. If anything happens to your application, to your server, right, that can't be affecting your Docker. That's why Docker is being used now, and it's highly scalable. If you want your right now you have your WebLogic which is configured in a Docker. If you want to create 100 instances of those applications, right, you can just create with a click. It will create 100 Docker containers within minutes, and it will start handling your code. But if you do in this traditional way, right, again you need to have a server, you need to provision that server based on Chef, you'll have some Chef code, all those. But if you have Docker, right, you can just do a copy paste type container. So that's that extensible. So still people are not getting used to those advanced concepts of DevOps. If you can simply replicate a container, that's not possible still with your traditional DevOps tools, your Puppet, Chef, all these things.
And Gautam, here small question. I know this is extendable opportunities. See that container. So you said Docker, right? So in my I have a one physical machine. There I run the two Dockers. Okay. So in two Docker containers. So in one Docker container, I deployed A application. Another Docker container, I deployed in B application. That B application had some issue and it was consumed the all the CPU utilization. So what will in this case? What kind of effect will get in the Docker A?
See, again, it will have it will be consuming your resources. If then it will completely affect all the containers. That there is no issue. But exactly. But what it does is it will give an isolation and it will only take those resources. So it's like a whenever you have APIs and the container-based applications, right? I'll be telling you Docker, so you will understand that. But Docker is not yet mostly implemented anywhere because due to the complexity of your changes to the application.
Exactly. This is here my question. So you are saying isolation, right? Where is the isolation here? So almost is I have to another Docker will be using all CPU utilizations. Obviously, the Docker two one is
it's
here,
the
right?
Resources, not the CPU resources, but the, all the other resources. The file open. If you have MQ, right, it will number of file opens, number of file close, and also how many ports it should use, how many open connections it should do to the other external connection. All those things. That I'll tell you because the way you're normal applications, Java applications, right, they'll not be able to completely take the advantage of DevOps. DevOps, whenever you have any application inside DevOps, right, it will be a small set of code, small set of logic which will be continuously running. It's not like it will have a huge number of works. It will not like I have a complete website in that. It will have a very small logic which will be continuously run in a large number of containers. It's not your traditional type of application like, okay, I'll deploy it to 100 MB or 200 MB of ER. It will have a small like 5 or 6 MB of a small jar files which will be efficiently running. So you'll not have much multiple works doing each container, right? It will only do a small set of tasks which will be communicated through between the Docker containers. Yeah,
okay,
understand
I
that.
Mean, literally literally like in-house applications. I mean, it's not
yes,
the huge
yes.
applications which are using by the public. Okay.
Yeah, that's why Docker will not be used by, you know, the small in-house application, not your heavy enterprise applications or a web application. It will not be used in that manner. Then, because you can't create small containers. Right? You create very small containers and you have specific tasks, but those tasks will be running in a huge number of containers.
Okay, understood. Thank you.
Yeah, that's why our companies will not at all touch DevOps because they don't want to break their the way they're writing the code. So most of the people think that DevOps means okay, it's a dev and operations, but it's not dev and operations. It's a complete collaboration between all the teams inside your development, operations, networks, and their build and deploy teams. So DevOps only exists in cloud. Most of the people think that okay, DevOps means it will only be implemented in cloud. So it's not. Most of the companies have started implementing DevOps in their traditional data centers, which are private clouds. So DevOps is a single product. No, DevOps, everyone thinks, okay, if I install one software or configure software, it's not going to happen. DevOps is a combination of multiple products in multiple phases, which are running in an automated fashion. So everyone will tell DevOps, no, DevOps is not, it's a myth. No, there is no DevOps there, but all the organizations right now are started or like already in the first or second phase of implementing their DevOps. Some people think that okay, if DevOps will come, then our jobs will go. No, though it's a DevOps, you need to have all your teams there. Your Java team will be there, your build team will be there, your middleware team will be there. But middleware will not be anymore configuring your WebLogic, but they'll be configuring your Puppet or Chef. So people will be there. Jobs will not go, but the tools will be different. The way of interacting will be different. But a single person can't do a complete DevOps because you need to have still a developers and the operations teams continuously working. Some people will think, okay,
here I'm an app administrator. So as an app administrator, what are the things I'm going to do in DevOps?
Okay, your application support, right?
Yeah, correct.
Okay. So application support guys, it will not be still the same because you are still the production support team, right? So the production support team still will be the same. You will not have any differences, but it's not yet there to the production support guys because once the code is in your production, right, the production support team will not get much, issues because once the DevOps is in pipeline, but from your part, you learning the Puppet and Chef, how it's deployment, that will be very helpful for your, instead of your learning the Jenkins part, right? If you are good with your Puppet and Chef, how it is managing your code, that will be helpful for a operation side, not the all other tools, but these tools will be important for you. The Nagios monitoring tools and your continuous deployment and delivery tools, which are your Chef or Puppet. Because those will be the tools which you will be handling, because some people may ask you what is a current configuration, what is the state of WebLogic which should be in a specific timeline, because if you want your applications to be down at specific time, right, you have some scripts already in place so that it will restart your applications every day. So you need to have the last two pipelines, which is delivery and your monitoring phases, not the earlier phases. You need to concentrate on these phases.
Okay.
So some people write. Yeah, tell me.
So if I'm going for middleware administrator, so what are the tools in helpful to work on DevOps?
It's a middleware administrator job or a DevOps administrator what? Because if you're DevOps, then so you'll be completely handling your Jenkins, your Chef and or your Nagios. These three things will be compulsorily done, but if you have a huge organization, right, people, they tend to take specifically for Jenkins, Build and Maven and Puppet and Nagios. So it can break to two parts, but not more parts. If you, either you'll be handling both the Jenkins, Nagios and Puppet, or you'll only be handling Puppet and Nagios, not Jenkins. So sometimes, right, they want a developer who can write some Java code, which will be helpful for Jenkins. So sometimes they may only hire people for the Jenkins part and the build part, or the part for the other deployment and monitoring part. But most of the organizations take it for all the tools. They expect you having knowledge in each of these tools, and also a Python scripting and shell scripting. Because most of, if you have a requirement and you start seeing that there is a task you are doing manually, then they ask you to automate it as soon as possible, because DevOps is a automation methodology, so every part will be automated. So I'll show you now, like what will be the what will be covering in the sessions. So introduction to DevOps. Right now we have completed this. So next we'll go to cloud computing, because most of the teams, right, they have a, either public or private cloud in their environment, so they expect you to know what is all the cloud implementations, how many types of clouds are there, what are the cloud models, cloud service models are there, cloud delivery models are there, and we'll also introduce to the AWS. Then we'll see the criteria, means you need to know the methodology, because knowing the couple of tools will not always be helpful. You need to know what, where to avoid, what is the ownership. And DevOps, right, it's not like a tools, it's like you see your infrastructure also as a code, because your infrastructure is something called you build a server. So that also can be coded, because you code that and you put a vagrant, and you put that vagrant code and you build it. So it's, everything will be seen as a code, not as a application or a product. And we'll be seeing the tools, all the tools in little detail again. So I know most of the people, right, who are coming for DevOps will not have a Linux administration part, because all the people who will be moving to DevOps will be the middleware administrator or the web administrators who are managing Apache or Tomcat or actual IBM or Oracle products. So I'll be covering the Linux administration, because the main part, right, once you go to DevOps, right, you need to start checking the, what you say, your operating system issues also, because you'll not have a specific, again, OS support team, because you will be the OS support team there. They'll ask you, okay, what is the network status, can you configure the DNS, what is the boot management, if they want to protect the more, the put more enforcement, right, they'll ask you to enable a couple of AC Linux features, the disk management, the boot management, all these things. So a couple of sessions we'll be covering Linux administration to get up to your speed, so that you'll also know what will be the main important tasks inside there as a Linux administrator. And we'll be also seeing the package installers, because you'll have a RPM for RHEL and apt-get for Ubuntu. So it's a little different when you install new packages, because there will be a lot of dependencies missing always, because whenever you install Nagios, Puppet or Chef, right, there may be a Ruby Ruby dependencies or Python dependencies or all these dependencies, right? So you need to continuously update your operating system. So we need to know the how to update your packages inside your this one. So and we'll go to the Vagrant. Vagrant is nothing.
Just a hold on. Yeah. I mean, Gautam, just a question. So yeah. You mean to say that if you want to be learn these DevOps tools, the prerequisite is a Linux admin. Is that correct?
Yes, yes. Always a Linux administrator will have the highest advantage because unless until you go to all this, what you say, the startups, right? Any other huge companies? Someone told he's from Wells Fargo. Someone told from all this Capgemini, right? The most first part who will what you say integrate this DevOps methodology, right? They start with Puppet or Chef, then they move to Jenkins, then they move to slowly. So when you do Puppet or Chef, right? Puppet and Chef always run on root, so they don't run on any other user. Puppet Chef only runs on root, and they have an extensive net operating system task to be completed. So and it's not like okay, you need to build servers, but you'll have your scripts ready, but you need to know what those services are. It's not like okay, all the Linux only Linux administrator can become web, because the Linux administrator will not have any idea about a delivery pipeline. What will be your code phase, deployment phase, all these things, right? So most okay. of the people are trying
my
to
question.
Yeah.
And understood.
Yes.
And I mean, my other question is: so these DevOps tools will not run in the Windows?
They'll run in Windows.
In Linux just is a mandate.
No.
So we can deploy
no
it in Windows
mandate.
As well, right?
Yes, you'll have your
okay.
Most of the time,
right?
Yeah, Chef server or Puppet server will have in Linux, but you can install those clients in most of the open source, Ubuntu, AIX, RHEL, Windows. Yeah, everything is for Windows. There is no issue.
I mean,
all
it's a cross-platform support, right? So I mean,
yeah,
I mean, I can okay, a centralized mission. I can able to kept it in the Linux. I mean, Windows, right?
Linux.
No problem, right?
Yeah, Linux or Windows. Yeah, there is no issue in that. But enterprises always tend to have their main servers, right? In the Linux, and those
okay.
clients can be across all operating systems. Vagrant will be covering because Vagrant is the most easiest way to create a RHEL, create a new server because you can just create a Vagrant within minutes because it's a type of what you say provisioning tool, server provisioning tool. You want a new new RHEL instance to be created and installed Tomcat, and you configure it and you provide it to a development team within a couple of minutes or some time so that for that Vagrant can be used. And you can destroy servers also within minutes. Means you don't want that instance, you can delete that Vagrant instance and create a new Vagrant instance. Because sometimes right, developers tell that okay, there is some operating system issue or some other issue due to that my application is not running. They will not have that. They can't complain that because the moment you give them, that will be a new server for them. They can go ahead and start doing their testings. Once you provision that, you need to, once we then we go to the JIT. JIT is a version control system. We'll be learning like how to install the JIT in Linux and Windows, how to create a repository, how to clone a repository, how to commit. Commit changes means developers do the commit, right? We'll see how to commit it. Then the branching. So once you have JIT, I'll be covering all the parts before the Jenkins, because before Jenkins, right, we'll need all these parts configured, then the Jenkins part will come. So then we'll go to the Chef. We'll be seeing the Chef terminology. There will be a lot of Chef things, Chef knife, Chef workstation, recipes. Recipes are nothing but a type of small software inside. So we'll be covering the Chef in detail, how to create environments, what are the nodes, test nodes, all this. Then you go to the Puppet. We'll see the Puppet. But we'll cover most of the, I'll try to cover both of them in most of the detail, the Puppet and the Chef. Then we go, when we'll move to the Nagios monitoring, how to install Nagios, how to create an email contact, how to verify the configuration, all these things. You can have a time period, you can set the alerts, you can have the host group, service groups, a contact group. Yes.
And Gautam, so in the Nagios, so did we get any common scripts? I mean, for monitoring the servers, adding the CPU utilization, are we
yes.
get any
so
common
that comes
scripts?
In the plugins. Plugins will come. You will find and install a plugin. So I told right, since these are open source, right, so many people who write those plugins, they'll share those plugins in a and we can create those plugins, and you can, once you have those, you create a new command, you customize them. Once you have, since these are monitoring tools, right, you'll have your scheduling downtimes, you'll have reports, you'll have notifications, all these things. Any, as a general, any monitoring tool has. Then comes the Jenkins. So what we have? We have our Vagrant, we have our JIT, we have our Puppet, we have our Nagios. What we can do is, we'll create a pipeline. We'll have all the parts which are required. So what we'll do, we'll have all these things. So we'll create a, we'll see, we'll install the Jenkins in multiple ways, and we'll configure Jenkins, we'll create jobs, and we'll do a build. Because once you have all those things, right, I can use those things to create a pipeline. Then we'll also be covering Docker. How to install Docker, what is a Docker, what is a Docker has some command line. Docker, right, when you have installed Docker and you have internet access, right, you can directly get a Docker container. It has an app store, and that app store is built into your command line. You can write Docker install directly, it will install a Docker. If you want your WebSphere, I told you, right, you can directly pull it from the Docker container itself, because IBM has done it as an open source one. Then we have a log management. What is a log management? Because there will be huge logs written across your servers, right? You can all manage through the Logstash. There are a couple of things, Kibana, all this, but Logstash is an open source one. And we'll also cover some basics about NoSQL databases. This is not required, but still I want to give you some information. The MongoDB and Cassandra, right? These are not your traditional, what do you say, object storage, how you storage in your tables, right? Primary key, all your tables, right? It will not be that. It will be stored in the format of files. That is called, it is NoSQL, because it doesn't have any standards of SQL, but it will be a, what do you say, very large storages which are efficient to handle. And we'll also cover a single day with the AWS. So I'll be moving this to the top, because most of you guys, right, if you want to all learn all these technologies, right, you having this, creating a server conversation will be very different. So I'll let you know how to create servers in Amazon. They'll be very, very cheap. Don't worry about that. It will be consuming my money. So for the first 1 year, one server will be given by Amazon freely. There is no issue. And also, if you use a server, right, at the most, it will only cost you 200 or 200 rupees for a whole month if you use it. So don't worry about AWS. It is going to cost me. It is very, very cheap. So I'll let you know how to create servers in Amazon. If once you know this, right, your learning curve will be very, very fast. You start learning anywhere, sitting in your office, sitting in your home, anywhere. So instead of you having a very huge RAM of 8 or 16 GB installing Dunning, right, it's very easy. So I let you know at the start itself how to create Amazon servers. So you learning anything will be very, very fast. So this is what I'll be going to cover. Any doubts?
So, I mean, what kind of, versioning control tool are we using? That is JIT one, no? Or SVN?
Yeah, JIT. SVN is old. It's not, again, compatible to your, what do you say, DevOps pipeline.
Okay.
Yeah, JIT is a number one tool, and there is a lot of support, and there is no alternative. Most of the alternatives also are not there, so.
Okay. So, as you said, JIT is an extension of Ant build, right? That's what you mentioned,
No. Maven is extension of Ant.
Okay.
JIT is versioning tool. These are build tools.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Yeah, Gautam, here is one question. Actually, in my environment, we have 20 machines. So, yes. Newly we got the requirement that we have to install WebLogic in 20 servers. So,
yes.
How can I show my client that by using these DevOps tools, I can save the money? So, how can I do that?
Okay, yes. So what you do first is you, for latest WebLogic, you install that base versions, and you start creating profiles, all these things, right? So what you can do is you can write automated scripts from your any one script, and you deploy it on your all your, first you configure your client, all these clients, and you on your server. And once you have a single script, right, you can use it to push it to all those servers at the simultaneously, instead of you don't need to configure your scripts and run it on each server. Once you configure that server, you write in a DSL language, domain specific language, to install your WebLogic within some steps, and you push that script to that, right, it will create that, it will install those all those softwares, and it will do a check that, okay, whether it has completed installation or not. So it's very easy. You no need to do all those tracks, and you no need to write Python or any specific scripts. You can directly write a code. You can push the code from all the server to the all the servers whichever you want to deploy it. And once you deploy, right, managing will also be very easy. You can always see all whether the permissions are all the same for whether specific users, whether there is a all the files are there, what is the latest version. You can continuously monitor it. Installing, yes, sometimes it's, but the way the managing those softwares will be a lot easier going forward, and installation upgradation also, because you can always make sure that it's in a desired state. What is a desired state? My file system should always be this much, otherwise send out a notification, all this. This is a desired state configuration. You can tell that this is the desired state for this server, and it should always make sure that it's in the desired state, otherwise it will alert it or do a changes by itself.
So here we can save cost by reducing the resources, right?
Yes.
So
you only have need a one person who writes a script and keeps pushing them.
Okay. So anyway, if I'm putting my WebLogic in 20 servers, I have to buy those 20 servers license, right? Even if I'm using these tools.
Yes, that is not. That's why whenever DevOps comes, people tend to use open source. Yeah. So that's why, right? So you'll be slowly implementing, not completely implementing. That's why, right? Your traditional organization, they are not going to implement complete DevOps. So your first step of DevOps will always be your Chef or Puppet, but that is the biggest component. Guys, any other doubts?